So yeah, so I'm from Queens, New York, and my talk is called From Rappers to Hackers. Why I left the music industry for technology. So I'm gonna share a story about myself, a kid from Queens, New York, who left the cutthroat world of hip hop for the cutthroat world of technology, and how dramatically shaking things up can actually improve your quality of life. So, QUE, another ENS, that's another way of saying Queens. I actually looked this up today, but Queens is the most diverse place on the planet, according to the Guinness Book of World Records. I didn't know that, which is kind of interesting. It makes sense. And I'm a video director and currently a senior media producer at Duo Security. I grew up in the 90s when music videos were big events, when MTV played really big videos, spent a lot of money on it. And early on, I knew that I wanted to tell stories through video. So eventually, I graduated with a fine arts degree and got a job in Manhattan creating motion graphics and things like that. In the city, I met a ton of artists, and I began experimenting, which essentially became my film school. Like many people who never went to film school, I made a bunch of mistakes along the way. But it was the best way that I knew how to learn and how to express myself. I didn't actually get into music video directing until about 2006, and it was actually by accident. And here's how it happened. I had a friend who worked at Def Jam Records, and one day he asked me to if I wanted to make a video trailer titled Blue Magic for this guy named Jay-Z. And I thought it over for a second, and I said, yes, I'll do that. So I shot this video in about an hour in New York City, just with my low-budget gear and a couple of friends, and my creative partner, Nancy. And I remember the first time that I met Jay, and it was at Quad Studios in New York City, and he was putting the finishing touches on American Gangster. And when we finished the video, his handlers wanted to show it to him, like, that day. So we sped over to Quad Studios, and the handlers told me to wait in the reception area, told the whole crew, and it made sense because if Jay didn't like it, he didn't have to meet me. why waste the time, right? So after about an hour of waiting, or it was about an hour or something, they said Jay wanted to meet, and they walked me into the studio, and it was like a long hallway. And I was really nervous, I was like, this is like meeting the Pope or Oprah, or I don't know. It was a really strange feeling. the first thing that he said to me, well, two things I noticed. The first thing was he was watching a bootleg of American Gangster that I learned later on he got from Denzel Washington. And the movie wasn't out yet. So I was like, wow, like Denzel's bootlegging his own film. And then the second thing I noticed, the second thing I remembered was Jay said to me, I see you're getting your name out there. And that was like, whoa. So I made this trailer, and it seemed like overnight it went viral. A few press outlets said that the trailer's gritty style evoked Jay's early work, like Where I'm From or 99 Problems. And it sent the message that any kid with a camera to run out there and shoot a major recording artist. The results were millions of online impressions and views, which ultimately helped the album reach numerous top 10 lists by 2007. And although the intention of the trailer was just as a straight-to-YouTube kind of video, major networks picked it up as broadcast content. So for me, it was like, okay, gritty, right? Low budget. All of this bad lighting and grainy footage, I guess, suddenly became trendy. It was like weird to me. But that was the beginning of my addiction to music videos. And this is kind of what my world looked like in 2007.
My next guest, Rik Cordero, if you've watched a hip-hop video in about the past 3 years, you're looking at about 50-50 odds that it was directed by Rik Cordero. He's completely revolutionized the hip-hop video-making industry. He's worked with, among others, Jay-Z, Busta Rhymes, Nas, The Roots, and I swear to you, ladies, made like 75 videos in the last 3 years.
Tell me something. You motherfuckers can't tell me nothing. I'd rather die than to listen to you. My DNA not for imitation. Your DNA an abomination. This how it is when you in the matrix. Dodging bullets, reaping what you're sowing. Stacking up the footage, living on the go and sleeping in the filler. Sipping from a cloudy walking in the building. Diamond in the ceiling, marble on the floor.
Guys, I got an idea.
The pool, Godfather goes, only Lord knows. I've been going hammer, dodging paparazzi, freaking through the cameras, eating four daughters, Brock wearing sandals, yoga on the money.
Y'all motherfuckers better stay tuned. Rik Cordero.
Phone never own, I don't ever
fuck, that's delicious.
I just penetrate sex, money, murder. These are the breaks, these are the times. Level number 9, look up in the sky. Tennis on the way, tennis on the way, tennis on the way. Motherfucker, I got winners on the way. You ain't shit without a buddy on your
fuck, you not Sid Jones.
On your plate. You ain't sick enough to put it on yourself. You ain't rich enough to hit the ladder skate.
Officially, the big homie Rik Cordero.
Gonna be our fate. Peace to the world. Let it rotate. Sex, money, murder,
idea. I'm often criticized as like lowering the standards of the entire hip-hop industry, but, you know, like, if I left, it would still, it wouldn't, you know, the budgets wouldn't suddenly rise, you know what I mean? So it's really just adapting to the technology.
It's really just adapting to the technology.
So, it's about adapting to the technology. I guess I called my own destiny back then. The music video industry back then in 2007, there were absolutely no rules. So it was about building my reel by any means necessary, regardless of cost. It was about undercutting every boutique video production, you know, company out in New York. And that led to a few music video nominations and some commercial awards. I got to work with some of my favorite artists and some of my favorite brands like Nike or Levi's and Heineken. And you know, all the press and all that attention eventually got me to sell some sugar water, believe it or not. And this is what selling sugar water looks like.
Guys, I got an idea. We open on a cheerleader.
Now you guys know how I get my ideas. Okay, good. Gave it away. Gave away the secret. So that was sort of my, you know, my jumping the shark moment, because eventually all that goodwill and this reputation as this street, you know, video director, this renegade filmmaker, it started to dissipate once that commercial started to air. You know, it's like I kind of went mainstream or I sold out. And, you know, another thing that the music, you know, labels never told me was I was exceedingly unlikely ever to see any real money from music videos. So most of the income that I generated around this time was from ancillary opportunities like that Sprite commercial. And on the rare occasion that I did get a decent budget, I had to spend it all on production. I had to put it all on screen. So that left very little money for my personal savings. This is around the time that the DSLR revolution happened. The 5D Mark II came out, so everyone was like shooting these amazing videos. And it got really crowded, the industry. And I started to get jaded, you know, working with music labels and managers and temperamental, you know, music artists. And, you know, my daughter was born and the pressure began to mount, so I lashed out. I started turning down music videos for Ludacris and for Diddy. And looking back, I think I was burned out from being the low-budget guy. So this gift of ushering in this new era of renegade filmmaking, it suddenly became a curse. And that led to, you know, my creative passion sort of dwindling, and that led to a decrease in work and clients and my savings. And with a new family to take care of, you know, I knew I had to make some serious moves. Another thing happened around this time. My dad got really sick. He had a double pneumonia, severe strain of the flu, and he was in critical condition for about 2 months and completely sedated. So this put a lot of stress on my family, and I became withdrawn, and I became distant. And I remember the doctor saying he wouldn't make it, like every week. And you know, my mom wasn't having it. She stayed by his side and prayed, kept the family together. And 5 months later, my dad was released from the hospital. And it was, I think, the first miracle that I witnessed, the first time I saw someone, you know, save someone else's life, and it was my mom. And so that was really inspiring to me. And my dad had a second chance at life. So I started to think about my own mortality. You know, how many birthdays did I miss because I was too busy working? Or how many weddings and baby showers were just not important enough to take a day off? So how many memories of my daughter was I willing to sacrifice for my work, for my art? And so some big changes were being thought of. It took a while. It wasn't quite that quick. But the first step was a brief but fulfilling stint creating branded content for media publishers like Complex Media in New York. But a lot of the work felt kind of repetitive and stale. It was the same pains of music video directing, just inside of a cubicle, I guess. And you know, but I'm from Queens, so I'm used to the suffering. I'm used to being on trains all day and, you know, dealing with noise and stuff like that. So, you know, I felt myself going around in loops and I wasn't being challenged. So I knew I had to make some changes because things were getting just too real for me. And what it came down to was I wanted a better quality of life for my family. My wife and my creative partner, Nancy, linked me up with Sam Valenti from Ghostly, introduced me through email, and he introduced me to Doug Song, CEO of Duo Security. And shortly afterwards, I got interviewed with the entire team, marketing team, and I scored a job as a senior media producer at Duo. My official offer letter actually came the day that we were packing, you know, that we were packing the truck, and I was hoping that, yeah, I'd actually have a job when I got there. And it came that day, and that was amazing. Perfect timing. So I just want to speak a little bit about the creative team at Duo. These guys are awesome. So the skill set of everyone on the creative team at Duo is as good as, or even better than some of the creative agencies that I've worked with in New York or Los Angeles. And the number one thing that stands out in our work is understanding the technology, internet security, and hacker culture. We're really good at figuring out the emotional connection of our product and how to hone that into a story. I also began to realize that rappers and hackers actually have a lot in common. They both want to overcome limitations. They both have a strong distaste for authority. And they both sometimes dabble in illicit activities. So not too different, right? what I'm trying to say is I didn't have to sacrifice my artistic integrity or my quality of life because I'm constantly being challenged with new ideas, but now I have the time and support to do them right. And it's the emotional response of our videos that motivates me. And I also want to give a shout out to Pete Baker, the big bearded guy back there. Definitely responsible for a lot of people's quality of life improving over at Duo. Also, and this is kind of cool, I have a basement. And now... Okay? Just think about that. Not everyone has basements, all right? So, and I've always been into DIY, and so I got in touch with my maker abilities that I didn't know I had, and I started building my own DIY electric longboards from scratch. Shortly after, I started the Carvon Racing League, which is the first ever electric skateboarding racing league in the US that I know of. And our prototype racing e-board, known as the Carvon Evo, which I built with my business partner in California, just got 148% funded on Kickstarter. So now my side maker hobby has turned into a very fulfilling creative project. And we'll be demoing our boards at Maker Faire in Dearborn in July. So if you guys are around, definitely come out to that. So basically, that's not a regulation. That's a disclaimer. So I'm still that hungry kid from Queens, so I won't stop making music videos. I love rappers, don't get it twisted. And I love street cred. I mean, it's important, right? Right? It's important to have that. You need that balance. So, you know, now that I've discovered this other industry for my skill set, I have a better perspective. I have a better grasp on my creative emotions and way less stress. I'd encourage anyone who feels like they're stuck in a rut or not feeling challenged to explore opportunities in other industries. Adapt your skill set to that role, and hopefully, like me, you may discover that the prospects are better while discovering other talents that you maybe didn't think you had. The A2 tech community, and Duo in particular, reflect a lot of the values that I found lacking in New York City. People here embrace creativity and collaboration to make something just a little bit more real and taking the time to do it right. I've also realized that healthy quality of life actually does exist. It's a thing. And before I go, I just want to give you guys a little sneak peek into what my life in the tech industry looks like these days.
Rick, you're a video director. What do you think we should do?
Yeah, Rick, how can we create a video that comes off as genuine and not desperate?
Thoughtful, but not too serious.
Clever, but not overproduced. Can my baby get it?
Thank you, guys.